Thank you all for coming tonight. We have a great presentation, I hope, for you tonight with some wonderful people that have agreed to come and join us here in Austin, Texas. First of all, let me welcome you to the, for those of you who haven't been to the Below building, our brand new home, because of the great gift of the Below and the Maroney families, we're now in this wonderful new building in this wonderful hall. We're here tonight for the McGarr Symposium, and I would not be happy if I didn't recognize the person who came up with the concept of the McGarr Symposium, and he is here tonight as well, Cappy McGarr. So, Cappy, thank you for all your help. Cappy would take credit for thinking this up, but he was inspired by his two daughters, who are both writers, and they're good writers. So thank you, Cappy, and thank you to them. Tonight's panel also wouldn't have happened without the help and support and the phone calls of one Steve Wisnot. Steve, where are you? Are you here somewhere? Where are you, Steve? Steve is a former managing director of the USOC and got to know some of these folks in that role and other roles that he had in the past. So, Steve, thank you for your help in this as well. Let me start off by introducing the folks on our panel, and then I'll tell you a little bit about how we're going to do this tonight and how it will take place, and then, of course, we're going to ask you to stand up and ask questions at the end. In no particular order, I'll start left to right. On my far left is Bill Bock. Bill is the general counsel of USADA, USADA. He is at least recently known for writing the so-called reasoned decision that led to the lifetime ban on Lance Armstrong. He's been general counsel or a counsel, but now general counsel for quite a few years to USADA since its beginning in 2001-ish, I believe, and so has really been involved in all of this performance-enhancing drug issue that that has engulfed cycling almost from the beginning of when it became such a public knowledge and public event and public controversy. Bill will be talking more about how all that came to pass tonight and his thoughts on it from the standpoint of USADA. Sitting next to Bill, doesn't really need an introduction, the three-time Tour de France winner, Greg LeMond. If you've ever thought about riding a bicycle more than about 10 miles and then multiply that by hundreds of miles and then do it three times faster than anyone else, I think you'll appreciate what this man has done. I can't sit on a bike for more than about 10 minutes. I can't imagine how he can do it for hundreds and thousands of miles. So Greg won the Tour de France in 1986, 1989, 1990, was the first American to win, and now, given the decision of USADA, the only American to win the Tour de France. And to do it three times is tremendous. Greg has been an outspoken advocate of appealing for those to ride a natural without any performance-enhancing drugs. Part of that decision that he made to be such an outspoken advocate has caused a lot of pain and a lot of turmoil to him and to his family, and it'll be one of the things we'll talk about tonight. Sitting next to Greg is a woman who is never afraid to say what she thinks, Betsy Andreu. Betsy is married to Frankie Andreu, and Frankie was the captain, I believe, in 1999 of the first Tour de France that Lance Armstrong won at that time since Strip. He was confronted, as all the other riders were, with the ultimate decision whether he would use performance-enhancing drugs or not. And as a result of an initial decision he made, there was a lot of pain and turmoil caused for him and his family. And Betsy's been an outspoken advocate of speaking out against the use of performance-enhancing drugs and a tremendous supporter of Frankie in his role as a world-class cyclist. So, Betsy, thank you for being here as well tonight. Sitting to Betsy's left, and it's probably appropriate they're sitting together because they are good friends, and to hear them talk about each other is tremendous, is Greg LeMond's wife, Kathy, who has gone through all of the pain and the turmoil that Greg has gone through over the last 15, 20 years over the same issues. To think that it doesn't impact the family at home, that you're just riding a bike somewhere and all the issues go away, is just not true. And Kathy's been on the front lines with Greg, and so it's appropriate, and actually we wanted Kathy to be here with Greg because it's not just his story, it's the story of Kathy and Greg LeMond and their family. So Kathy, thank you for being here as well. And last, but he would tell us not least, is a gentleman I actually met a few years ago in New York, haven't really seen him since, Reed Albergotti from the Wall Street Journal. Reed has actually just written a book that you can pre-order on Amazon called Wheelmen, right? And that examines the history of cycling in the United States or world-class cycling over the last, I think, 40 years or so. He can tell us more about it, I'm sure he will. Reed has been writing for the Wall Street Journal for many years and has been covering cycling. And I remember the byline with his co-writer of his new book, Vanessa O'Connor, back in 2010 when they wrote a story about Floyd Landis about how Floyd was confessing to using performance-enhancing drugs. And I remember that was the first time I think I saw the byline from Reed about cycling, and he's been doing it ever since. So Reed is here with us tonight to comment from the standpoint of the media, and the Fourth Estate is well represented. So thank you, Reed, for being here. All right. So what we're going to do tonight, it's not just a simple panel discussion. I was inspired several years ago. I got a chance to meet a gentleman who I really respect a great deal, a very well-known lawyer by the name of Arthur Miller. No, not the playwright, but a famous Harvard lawyer who started a series of panel and public discussions back in the 1980s called the Fred Friendly Series, and he won several Emmys on PBS. And he liked to have a public conversation with the people that he would bring in. And so he wanted these people to feel like they were in a living room and they were having a conversation amongst themselves, and he would spur the conversation a little bit, but he tried to stay out of it. So that's what we're going to try and do tonight, is have a little living room conversation with these folks. And I'll try and stay out of it as much as I can. If it needs a little lead somewhere else, I'll jump in and probably will summarize a few things where necessary. But they're all ready to have that conversation. If you see them stepping on each other a little bit, it's because we told them to. Feel free to have that conversation, talk about the issues. Before we start that, let me just read something to you that Bill sent to me. You know the title that we're dealing with tonight about cycling and the culture and the price that you pay in being involved in the culture of cycling. And Bill sent me this quote that came from Lance Armstrong during a deposition in a lawsuit involving payment of some bonus money. And when Lance was asked about the mentality that you have to have when you're involved in cycling, this is what he said. "We had one goal and one ambition, and that was to win the greatest bike race in the world, and not just win it once, but to keep winning it. And I suppose we could have been viewed as ruthless and evil and mean and cheaters and crooks and thieves and frauds, but we were not particularly remorseful to the people that came across us. We had this goal, this ambition, and it was our responsibility to perform and to do our job." That was the mentality of the team at that time. One of the teammates of Frankie and of Lance also wrote a book, Tyler Hamilton. We invited Tyler here tonight. Tyler couldn't come. But in his book, he talked about that mentality. He said this: "The thing was, Lance was always different from the rest of us. We all wanted to win, but Lance needed to win. He had to make 100% sure that he won every time, and that made him do some things that went way over the line as far as he was concerned and in his opinion. I understand that he did a lot of good for a lot of people, but it still isn't right in the end." And that was Tyler's comment. So with that in mind, with a couple of comments about what it is, this mentality, this culture of cycling, let's have a little bit of a discussion. Reed, I'm going to start with you. We may as well start with the 50,000-foot view, the guy who's not participating, the guy who's watching it. If you were given an assignment to write about cycling as it exists today with all the revelations, what would you say about where we are in cycling, what that culture is, and is there a hope for it the way we're looking at it today?
Yeah, I mean, I think, the 50,000-foot view, I mean, I'm not a cycling reporter, so to speak. I mean, I sort of take a business approach to this whole thing. But yeah, I mean, I do think that there is a hope for cycling. I think that you have to take this story that we're all here talking about today and sort of separate it from, you know, specifically just the sport of cycling, because it's so much bigger than that. And I think, you know, we probably, everyone in here, most of the people in here, watched the Oprah interview and saw that. I mean, that admission, I can probably speak for everyone on this panel, was not news. And, you know, it was really just the very tip of the iceberg. And I think I see the Lance Armstrong story and the story of everyone here is it part of the whole thing, cycling, Lance Armstrong, it was a multinational corporation, really, with ties to, you know, you had the International Cycling Union that was tied to the International Olympic Committee. You had the U.S., you know, Cycling Federation, and that was tied to the U.S. Olympic Committee. You had big name sponsors like, you know, Nike, multinational corporations, Bristol-Myers Squibb, I mean, huge, huge companies, and you had the owner of Lance Armstrong's team, Tom Weisel, who, you know, founded the most prestigious investment bank in Silicon Valley. And all of it was sort of designed or had as one of its major goals to keep this one secret and to not let it out. And everyone on this panel at one point or another kind of stood in the way of that juggernaut, of that huge multinational corporation keeping its secret. And they all paid some price at one point or another. I mean, Betsy, you mentioned her husband was really blacklisted from the sport of cycling. Greg started a cycling company, a bike-making company that was a global brand, very successful. He lost that all fell to pieces. There was a lot lost in this whole story. And I think that's my 50,000-foot view of this. And then you have the sport of cycling over here, and it needs to just sort of figure out how to rebuild its image and its brand. But that's what I'm interested in hearing from everyone else.
I think as long as the UCI is involved with the current management, I don't have as much hope for the sport. because they turned a blind eye. They saw under Hein Verbruggen and Pat McQuaid, you had the biggest scandals in cycling occur, and they just didn't care. And as far as I'm concerned, Lance had the perfect story because he was the cancer survivor. He was there into the North American market. So they just turned a complete blind eye to everything. Lance had the perfect story. He was the UCI's pawn. If it hadn't been Lance, I think it would have been somebody else. But he had the perfect story and the same ethics. And so the combination with Lance and Hein Verbruggen created, it insulated Lance, and it really helped to put him on this pedestal and to create this big global brand that just seemed untouchable.
You know, the win-at-all-cost attitude certainly pervaded the team, as you shared, Mike. But I think that same sort of attitude also pervaded the sports governing body, and they viewed Lance as too big to fail. And that's a lesson for all of us. No body, no institution, nothing is too big to fail. And what has just come out in the last week are the records from the 2001 Tour of Switzerland test results. And the UCI had evidence, scientific evidence, in its possession in 2001 of the presence of synthetic EPO in Lance Armstrong's urine samples. Now, they didn't meet the positivity criteria to declare it a positive test, but as a scientific matter, it was known that there was synthetic EPO in those samples. And what did the UCI do over the course of time? And you heard time and time again, they lifted Lance up as the face of the peloton. Every cyclist that came forward and tried to tell about doping within the peloton, they cut him off at the knees, perpetuating the omerta within the sport. And then when Lance is going to make his comeback, in 2008, and there's a rule that says that he has to serve time in the registered testing pool, they waived that rule for somebody that they now admit they knew had synthetic EPO in his urine sample.
And the same management is in charge today.
Yeah.
Same management is in charge today.
And you know, we also know that how interconnected the U.S. cycling, you know, the U.S. Postal Team, essentially, and all of American cycling was with the UCI. I mean, Armstrong, we now know, made donations to the UCI. We also know that the president of the UCI at the time, and by the way, they were in charge of drug testing. I don't know if we'd spelled that out. The president of the UCI had a brokerage account with Tom Weisel, who owned the U.S. Postal Team. So it was very interconnected financially and otherwise.
Conflict of interest is a foreign concept, for sure, to the UCI, apparently, because, as you said, they're taking money from a cyclist. And they had in their files the records that cyclist should be considered to be suspicious for the use of EPO, and yet they're taking money from it.
When you talk about the tests, they wouldn't have been positive at the time. Have you studied them? Would they have been considered positive now?
There are certain things that would need to be further analyzed, but we saw a lot of things when we looked at the test results. But one of the things is that they only took 45 to 50 milliliters of urine. It's almost like they didn't want to catch somebody because they weren't taking enough sample to do reanalysis. And then in the 2001 Tour of Switzerland, They had two samples that the laboratory specifically flagged as highly suspicious for EPO and one other sample that they analyzed, but there were two more and they didn't even analyze those. Then a few weeks later, Lance goes to the Tour de France and he's tested 10 times and only five of them are tested for EPO. So as we've gotten further and further into this, we've been distressed to see that this was not a sport that was focused on making the playing field level for all its athletes. And we can go into that, but I don't want to. But I mean, how does that make you
well, feel, I think, graduate? I mean, I think that cycling, I think that the issue even with, let's say, Armstrong and what's happened over the last 50 years, that actually goes way beyond doping. People think it's just, oh, he's somebody taking a little pill. But if you go back into the late 80s, early 90s, two doctors, Dr. Furyk and Coney, had a system and perfected blood doping. Then Coney was, in research for the IOC to test for EPO. At the same time, he's giving professional riders EPO receiving cash. And during that period from 1990 to 95, I don't know, 100 riders have died. I mean, in their sleep.
These aren't benign substances.
There was a whole rash of justification. Oh, heart virus, but how many riders? They perfected, they've got it down safe to a safer level, but those 100, that's...
They're real lives. 100
plus more have died.
Yeah.
But it goes back, goes back to the very, cycling was always kind of a free market sport where you had Tour de France, you had teams. UCI was literally just a place where you, USA Cycling, they were a place where you actually sent in your registration, got your fee, paid your fee, they gave a calendar, they trained officials to go out. The USA Cycling Federation existed for the Olympics and the World Championships, and they put on the National Championships. And I go back to even the 84 Olympics, and if you understand what happens, there's an economic drive. All the coaches there, if you get a medal, you get $2 million more funding, which means a better job security, and literally before the 84 Olympics, I mean, I know a lot of the riders on it, these guys were told they have to blood dope. They were just weeks before the Olympics, and they heard that the Italians and Russians were doping. And I think back to that, where there was a financial incentive by people who weren't the riders. The riders weren't making a choice. They were like, this is what you have to do. And riders are young. I mean, they're very impressionable. But cycling has always had doping issues. I hear that argument. It was a sport that actually been in the forefront for drug testing. Mm-hmm. By the 70s, 80s, they were, detecting amphetamines, basic testosterone, anabolics. I mean, anabolics they were testing. You know, I'd say mid-80s is when Conconi Ferrari came in with this doping, steroids. By the late 80s, early 90s, it was EPO. And it literally changed overnight, 1 year to the next. And it was, they call it a race of two speeds. But it was, when you think about these riders, a lot of these guys weren't even aware of what they were taking. It was, this is a hormone, this is good for you. And eventually, I watched the riders who weren't doing that. I watched the economic impact of our team. The team that I was on, Z team, then it turned again. I remember 1993, now I won the tour with that team, paid a lot of money for 3 years to win multiple tours. I won one. The following year, 91, was seventh place, but when you're a racer for 10 years, there are no miracles. You know who your competition is. You know that this guy, I'm challenging him, and it's a matter of peaking. But everything got thrown out the window, and our team went from winning to the individual and to winning the team classification, and by 1992, we weren't finishing half the team in the tour. And then I saw 1993, sponsor, 92, the sponsorship was up, and we had a sponsor, GAN, which was insurance company. I broke my back here. This is why I'm sitting in this. It's not a girl.
And he's still
it's
here.
It's not a weight loss deal. It should be. But
I'm going to interrupt you because you brought up something about the people, the deaths that occurred. And I know Kathy wrote a very personal memoir on your website. And Kathy, I'm sure not everyone has seen that. But that hit home very quickly to you.
It hit home to us because... Greg was on a team called PDM, and while Greg was on PDM, they had a positive of two riders, testosterone, that Garrett Yantunis had won at Alpe d'Huez, and that afternoon, Greg had some tendon surgery. We were in Minneapolis. We got a phone call, and it was the coach saying, we got it figured out. we got the secret. You know, Greg's going to win more tours.
And Greg and I were like, that. He actually said,
"Yeah,
we have the program, kind of like training, whatever." It was very vague, and he said, "You're going to win more tours than you ever dreamed."
Right.
And I'm like, "Okay,
okay.
What is this?" And 2 days later, Gift on Denise was positive.
It was positive, and then Greg immediately said, "You got to fire the fire."
I
everybody.
Came back two or three weeks later, and you know, I'm like, "Holy cow!" I was injured that year, and it turns out
but
that was the first
about
team
you,
that was organized doping.
So that really was one of the first teams we ever had experience with doping, that it was very clear their intention was to dope the riders. And as it just came out, they did dope all the riders on the Tour de France that year. On that team...
What year was that?
88.
And that year, we became friendly with another Dutch couple and his young American wife. And... long story short, one time the next year after we had already left PDM, they came down for dinner one night, and Annalisa says to me in the kitchen, "Oh, we figured out what's wrong with Johannes. He's low on testosterone." And Greg and I are like, "Everyone is low on testosterone on a Monday after, you know, you do a stage race. That is completely normal to be low on testosterone. You know, you're not going to have a big sex drive after a... after a big stage race. No, it takes a couple days. Anyway.
That was my sign of recovery. Okay. That was horny.
Too much information. We are famous for that. Well, anyway, so. But
we can spend the next hour on it if you'd like. But go ahead.
So anyway, so we tried to talk to Annalisa and Johannes and say, you know, this is how they get you started. And if you look at Tyler's book, that's what happened to him. How he like broke that barrier. But about a year and a half later, and we were friendly, but we were not friends. In the middle of the night, our phone rang, and it was pitch black in our bedroom, and Greg was home. And I found the phone, and I picked it up, and it was Annalisa Dreyer. And she was screaming. And she said, "Johannes is dead. He is dead in the bed." And he had been on an EPO program, and they had overdosed him. And I don't know why
but
her...
dead, I mean, literally, would she tell
him? Actually dead, waiting for the hospital, for the ambulance to come. And she chose to call us. And it was only because we were American. And...
well, you talked to her, too.
Yeah, and so she came down and spent that next week with me at my house. And the whole time was... she was hysterical. She knew he had been on a doping program, and she wanted the autopsy results. And
we never heard from her.
We never heard from her. After a week of me calling, begging management for the autopsy, for more information, they convinced her to come back up to Eindhoven by herself. And I never heard from her again.
Although she did
speak to the New York Times and said that it was an EPO death.
And but you, she told you, or you learned that the condition of his heart...
it was as though they told her his heart was shredded.
But that lends into the version that it was a virus. I think it was EPO. You know, we don't know for sure, but that was the first of two teammates that died. And after, I would say, 93, we went into the GAN. My last 2 years was GAN insurance. And, you know, already I won the tour, and I didn't even finish the 92. Couldn't even start 93. And part of that is, you go through all these questions, and I have lead pellets in me, and I got shot, and I'm thinking I'm not training right, I'm eating too much fat, I'm skimming off fat, I'm just, you know, I didn't ever think about somebody's doping, and, you know, and then we flipped teams, and the pressure was like, for me, I mean, I took a reduction in my pay, went on a bonus, but everybody did. But 93, we were even worse, and finally, one of my teammates knew somebody in ONCE, and he stood up and he said, "Listen to our coach, Roger Leger. You know, listen, this is what they're doing, EPO, growth hormone, testosterone, blah, 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 probably 10 different drugs." And it was odd because he said, "Either you provide the same or you lay off. You know, you can't tell us to do something we're not capable of. These guys are, you know, everybody's juiced to the gills." And more power to my coach, Roger Leger. He said, "I can't do that. Ethically, I couldn't do that." And that's a period when people were dying. So he left our team 93 for 94 for an Italian team. And he was, the last time I saw him was in Turbromandy, Switzerland, and he's with a teammate, Eric Boyer. And he came up, and he's had a great attitude. I mean, as a person, he was always laughing, and he came up laughing at us. He's like, oh, you guys, you have no clue. You guys, no way you're going to compete. He said, I just did the Tour of Spain. They call it breathing through your nose. And I said, I didn't even train. I went through the Tour of Spain 3 weeks. I didn't feel my legs. And I heard that. That's the first time I ever heard not feeling my legs at all. And the breathing through your nose, that's what you'd say when you're riding really well. You're not suffering. But he left. And I told my teammate, Eric, I said, it's time to get out. And I didn't. It wasn't even really a choice. I was dropped in the sixth stage of the tour. Went 4 years before I won it. I won it three tours. And I couldn't make it. And it was basically I was chronically overtraining. Because one of my teammates, Juan Fernandez, the only other person I ever met, he's admitted to doping, but
But he didn't do EPO.
He wasn't doing EPO, which is really the driver.
But you forgot to say that Philippe Cassidy.
Anyways, Philippe Cassidy. Philippe Cassidy died of a heart attack in 1995, January 1995. You know, months after I finished.
Those accounts really, you know, bring it home. I mean, when somebody's lost their life, and one of the things that just flabbergasted me as I sat down with many of Lance's teammates to find out that the health risks of using these drugs had never been explained to them. I mean, the misconception within the peloton, I think, is that there isn't that much of a risk.
Well, these guys put the trust in the doctors. And so when the doctors say, don't worry about it, I'm monitoring what's going on, you're going to be fine.
Ferrari
had said that. They put their trust in these doctors. I can tell you in 1999, when Frankie was told he had to take a shot, and he asked, what is it? And Luis Del Moral said, don't worry about it. And he asked, what is it? Don't worry about it. You want to start the race? I wouldn't give anything that would hurt you. And he took the shot. And I didn't find out about this until years later. And I asked Frankie, why would you do that? That's just stupid. I would never take a shot. And he said, what was my option? The next day I'm not going to start the race and they're going to say I have some saddle sore? And he said it was under the doctor's supervision. So they deemed it okay.
The whole environment is tremendously coercive. And so one of the things that's in the report is the story of David Zabriskie and how he began doping in 2003, thought he was going to be commended for how he had finished in the Tour of Dunkirk, and the team director called him to a meeting, said, yeah, you did a great job, you have a lot of potential, but the guys in front of you in the race are using performance-enhancing drugs, the guys behind you are, and the only way you're going to succeed is to do it. So they broke him down. And I won't go into the details, pretty dramatic story because of the convictions that he had not to use drugs because his father had actually had a drug problem.
By the way, let me interrupt you real quick. He was deemed the successor to Lance. From what I recall, he was going
very
to be this. Pardon me.
He was a very big talent.
Yeah, great talent, and yet he couldn't compete on the same level.
Right, and was it, but there was kind of there's an art to convincing these guys to use these drugs. David joined the team at $45,000. Second year, they cut his salary in half. He's not making a lot of money. He's got this dream. He gave up college to pursue the dream. He's apart away from his family, in a country where he doesn't speak the language. Young kid around all these hardened professionals, he's basically on his own, and now he's being told by the guys that he put a lot of respect and and who control his career that he's got to break this ethical barrier, and. These guys are all, to a certain extent, they're almost defenseless. We talked about Christian Vandeveld and when he got off of Ferrari's program, Lance called him in and started talking with him about the need to be on the program. So it's a tremendously coercive environment for the riders.
But I think the biggest crime in that is there was one winner there was on the Postal Service. Everyone else was domestiques and disposable, as we all saw. It was all for Lance. It was all for Brunel. It was for the management. Those were the guys that got rich. These young guys, like Frankie, they didn't get rich. You didn't get on the program, you got cut.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah, to that, you didn't get on the program, you got cut. Look, the Frankie used EPO. I was never going to be one of the wives who said, it's okay. I want my Cartier sunglasses. I want my line of Louis Vuitton luggage. I want to drive a nice car, go on nice vacations, have a big house. It wasn't going to sit with me. Lance wanted Frankie to, and this is our story, because our story is a little different than everybody else's. Lance wanted Frankie to see Ferrari early on. And Frankie said, no, don't want to be associated with Ferrari. I'm not going to go there. Frankie ended up using EPO. 1999, Frankie had used EPO when he had ridden the tour with Lance. There was a huge, big fight that ensued when I found out that Frankie had used EPO. He said, I won't use it again. 2000, he rode clean. He was chided. And it's in the, you can get it, you can see the emails even before 1999, before the 1999 tour, how Lance chided Frankie for not being a team player, for not doing what it takes, for being selfish, for being arrogant. And in 2000, Frankie rode the tour clean. He refused to get on a doping program, and it cost him his team. Not only did it cost him his job with the team, with the Postal Service, but Johan went to the teams that had talked to Frankie and made offers to him, and then those offers went away because Johan had badmouthed Frankie to those teams. So it was a...
What was the cost of Ferrari? It was different
for everybody. Because one point that I want to say is when Kathy said a lot of guys didn't get rich, I think a lot of guys did get rich.
Right.
If you were on Lance's team, you made a lot of money.
But
if you were on
stingy.
The doping program,
I'm sorry,
you made a lot of money being on Lance's on the tour team.
What was that if you got onto that 9-man squad? I mean, what was the dollar figure that...
I think when I spoke with David Walsh, when Frankie was pulling on Sestrier in 1999, and he did really well, he was a power horse just on EPO. Frankie went... The doping that was occurring on the team was foreign to Frankie until he read Tyler's book, because they had the two camper vans. They had the one that they called Chitty Chitty Bang Bang that Frankie and the other guys who were on the complete program were on, and then they had the one for Kevin and Tyler and Lance. And in 2000, when Frankie wasn't doing it, it was... it was career over. But David Walsh had estimated, he said, and David Walsh is the average journalist who was arguably one of the very first journalists to go after Lance, said that had Frankie been with Lance on the program, we could have had millions in the bank. We wouldn't have to worry about paying for college. We wouldn't have to worry about paying the mortgage or me opening up my mouth to say this is wrong and we have to do the right thing. We wouldn't have to do that.
No, but my point is Lance presumably made $15 or $20 million a year, and the guys that were jeopardizing their health to help him make $15 or $20 million a year, even if they made $1 million a year.
And I know Kevin Livingston was making about maybe $300. He asked for $400.
But how much?
It wasn't worth it to the team, and he left to, I think it was telecom, so he made $600 or $700. So it, actually, they weren't making the premium. They weren't getting that.
Right.
They weren't getting what, imagine, if, I always think, Frankie and all these writers literally give themselves to a leader. And what I think what separates, and I would say that most of these cyclists, I would say 99% are not bad people. They're cyclists, they're people you know. It's kind of like drug addiction. It doesn't really discriminate. And the sport does have, but there are people who actually choose not to do it. So like a guy like Christophe Besson, he ended up making zero because you didn't have it. If you didn't do it, you're out. You couldn't compete. You would not.
But Frankie rode clean in 2000.
But he didn't make. He didn't have a job after that.
Well, yeah.
Right. So,
but you could compete. No, but my point is, you could compete.
Of course, you could compete.
You could compete, but weren't going to make hundreds and hundreds of thousands
of
dollars.
Like you said, though, the culture was, there were very few teams. The French teams were probably the exception that actually, the 98 Festina affair was so dramatic, and the government actually implemented extra drug tests, and it was such a big risk, and I think that there were a few riders, a few teams that were able to keep on, but the culture of Pulseville, Frankie didn't do it, you know, he wasn't welcome there. That's kind of what
I'm
saying.
And that's why I think in 2000 was the turning point, because when they, Frankie rode the tour, he rode well, but he was chided from not being strong enough, not doing what it takes, and his salary was cut, and then he didn't have a team.
Right. Well, I'm saying there's, I look at it as incredibly selfish to actually ask people to juice themselves to the gill for the benefit of one person to make $20-30 million. Why?
Yeah, but
at least you share on the good.
No, I mean, see, I don't.
You're robbing the bank, split it between everybody.
No, but see, I don't. It's just like it shouldn't be acceptable in any way, shape, or form. I don't care if it's $5 or $1.
Hold on, we've been talking a lot about your personal experience, which we should. There is a few other guys out there who won the Tour de France in between you and Lance that were also doping.
Between me and Lance?
Yeah.
Oh, between I
Jan
my
Reese.
Reese.
I mean, Reese. Oh,
Jan Ulrich.
Ulrich.
And it's like Armstrong. In a way, I mean, there was a perfect storm. 98. Mm-hmm. You had this is actually kind of the perverse part of it, because it was pervasive. I mean, by 94, 95. And imagine, the joke was in 94, the highest paid rider in the peloton was Dr. Ferrari. he was taken 10, 15, 20% of the guy's salary. Income became pretty good at that point. Some right, on average, let's say the top writer's 50, making 400 grand, add that up. 50, yeah. You just add up the numbers. It's huge money for that one person. But by that was, 40, I'd say 40, 50, by 96, that was 80%. I watched the Stina French team. Everybody says, oh, the French have lost it. Well, the French have not lost it. It's that they're actually are not following other programs that other Italian teams, Spanish teams, US Pulse were doing. But by 1998, Festina Fair happened, and it scared the crap out of everybody. And the tour was brought to its knees. I was there the day the police were doing raids. So now you have a peloton that there's a big of them say, I know one person that knows Jan Ulrich very well, and here's a guy that is 60% hematocrit. He juiced, he had real talent. Second and first tour, first and second tour, at a very young age, 99, 2000, you know, believe it or not, but my friend knows very well and said he raced clean those 2 years, and I, you know, believe it or not, but this guy had a huge motor, and after 2 years, he realized he couldn't do it, and everybody, you know, he won the tour twice, doped, and everybody's assuming maybe everybody's going to do it. All you do is need one exception, one little bit of corruption, and I think that's what really happened in 99. So you have one guy who gets positive, gets a get out of jail card. That creates doubt and chaos within the riders. They don't trust the system, and that creates this, you know, shit. If he's not going to be held accountable, you know, it's a free-for-all.
There's, in our audience, if he'll tell me the statistic, is Dr. John Hoberman, from UT who did a study during the lawsuit with SCA. And John, your results showed that, what, 60%, 70% of the riders that were on the podium over a long period of time were ultimately found to be doping?
Yeah, that's about right. Between 19, I studied 1961 to 1998, and it was on the order of 70%. It was not, I didn't have all the research resources that you would have today, but it was stunning.
Yeah.
It was obvious that a large majority of these people could be enjoying the doping in one way or another.
So there's this culture out there, if you're not doping, you're not winning. And it starts happening on sort of on your watch when you're out there pedaling away, and all of a sudden you find out you can't do it anymore.
Yeah, I actually believe it. I mean, the thing is, I was very fortunate, and you know, I don't read forums. I've heard forums. You know, iron injections. I kind of laugh because if I took some illegal drug, I had a journalist with me, and I did. I had a hunting accident where I lost 60% of my blood volume, right lung collapse, lost 30 pounds of muscle mass, went from 140 to 121 2 years before. So I actually never even went to a medical doctor for a checkup. And I'm struggling. I'm coming back, and there's a lot of other things that happened to me. But, you know, I ended up having three iron injections just because of a friend that said I look like a woman who's menstruating. And I have no clue if they help. I know that I had horrible allergies. I know that it rained. Who knows if... You know, you go through cycles, but I know this, that I know riders that race clean, did Andy Hampson, Steve Bauer, Paul Coakley, the team I was on. I mean, anti-drugs, never saw any drugs on my teams. By the 60s, 70s, and 80s, it was a soigneur, it was a rider, never really organized. Now, I'm a little naive, I didn't realize, maybe some of the Italian teams were organized. PDM was the first one that I... You know, just said, this is crazy. And it wasn't even said. I had to kind of, it was just red flags were going off. This is not worth it. I left that team. It's not well written, but I had a contract for $200,000, 88, 89, $400,000. And I went back and said, Denise is off. Whoever gave him the drugs are off. And within 2 weeks, my name was trashed. They said I was, you know, how dare I? I haven't raced that year because I was injured. He's asking for a raise, and I actually, it was worked out really well, but I ended up going with the team and made got paid the day after I won the tour a year later. But I just chose not to be
but
on
there,
a team.
There were different drugs in the 60s, 70s, 80s. Everything changed with the blood,
drugs
oxygen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've got a question, Mike.
Yeah.
I mean, John points out how the substantial percentage of the Peloton that was doping. We know this has been going on for 20, 30 years. Somebody that observes, Reed, you're observing the sport. You know, I know this is supposed to be our business, but how are we going to change it? What can be done?
Well, a little above my pay grade, but maybe I can weigh in. I mean, you know, I don't, obviously, what one thing that we've learned in covering this is that drug testing alone just doesn't work. I mean, I think, and you know, one thing to point out, I mean, I don't know how familiar with the audience is with the history of all this stuff, but USADA is not that old. I mean, really, it was created about the same year Lance won his first Tour de France. So it's really grown, or maybe the next year after, actually. So, you know, it's really grown up with, as this whole scandal unfolded, USADA really grew up, and I think, you know, I can speak for you here that USADA probably realizes that drug testing alone will not do the job. There has to be intelligence gathering. There has to be, you know, you have to offer, like USADA did, riders deals to, you know, when they do get caught, to come in and just come clean and talk about everything they know, how the doping works, how they're getting around the tests, and to get smarter at it. But I think the underlying thing that needs to change is the culture of sports. Yeah. It will never, I mean, the only thing that can really clean up cycling and just all professional sports, and maybe even not professional sports, is just the culture, people not wanting to dope anymore. And I, you know,
But there's huge incentive to dope. When you have companies like Nike who back an athlete like Marion Jones, when, okay, everybody wants, we have to have proof. There is so much smoke. Where there's smoke, there's fire. There was so much smoke with Lance. But everybody, so many journalists hid behind, we have to be objective. We can't report this because then we're not going to be objective. So you have to have investigative journalism as well. I mean, I agree with the points that you made. But when it comes, the governing bodies have to truly be a governing body. The UCI, for example, I found out that Floyd Landis was positive before Floyd knew he was positive. Because Greg found out and he called me and he said, you're not going to believe it.
First guy to hear about it.
But that's part of changing the culture.
That's part of changing the culture.
Nike.
Who did you hear? Brother of the president of UCI.
Why do you think he called you and told you?
Actually, I know him. He's a nice guy. And he's, you know, the sport was actually, I think his brother was brought in to hopefully change a little bit, but he's more old guard. And it was like, holy shit, can you believe this happened again? But I found that's part of the, to me, I mean, it's, the drug testing just has to be separated from the UCI. It's got to be.
Yeah,
once that happens, it needs to be USADA, WADA, police intervention. What people don't realize is that play the game, and Donati spoke, and it isn't just a little few drugs. It's part of the drug trafficking in Europe.
When Declan called you, though, did he tell you, did he tell you don't go around and tell people? Or I mean,
well, he was like, holy, he was actually shocked. He was like, and I had written Pat McQuaid to say, God, I'm glad you're in. I'd love to talk to you about how to improve the sport. I actually think there's a lot of solutions to actually watch and profile and actually catch 98%. And I want to get to where I could see cycling go. That's a real winner. That's his basic foundation of talent.
One other thing that I think is, I think the general public has a responsibility to understand, this is cheating. You know, this is cheating. Why are we okay with it? We shouldn't be okay with it. We aren't okay with our kids cheating in school. I don't want my kids cheating in school. And I think that, you know, like, why are we pardoning it? It's criminal activity, and it's ruining sports. And I just don't understand why, like, Greg said I was very rude to the bellman yesterday, but it was like, I am against cheating.
That's not
and
it.
He was like,
19-year-old kid said, well, you know, it's like, it's, they've got to really be able to do it and reinforce it. And he's fairly naive in saying, well, then they should just, otherwise it's above board. And I didn't even want to,
legalize doping for everyone.
She got into a whole
I think
we should get him on the panel.
What hurts the athlete is sometimes they're not shamed. To hurt them financially. I think that any athlete who has ever caught doping, and then if they fight it, they've got to pay USADA back the money. I think any athlete who has caught doping has to pay back money to the team. They have to pay back the money.
Does Lance Armstrong make $100 million if he doesn't dope?
No, he would never have won a single tour.
I'm not agreeing, actually, with some of the women. I'm teasing. I'm agreeing in principle. But I think that...
What are you disagreeing with?
Just hear me out.
Okay.
As long as I'm asking.
See, we're going to finish it by 9 o'clock. You're going to hear about this tonight. That's the problem.
The riders want... They don't trust the UCI.
No, they want
it separated.
You're right.
If they know that there's real people held accountable, and the only way to get that accountable is to work with the riders, work with the teams, work with police. And I believe, I'm actually a believer that a guy gets positive one time, he gets a chance to come clean. And imagine 25 years ago, if a rider's positive, he gets one chance to out a supplier. All of a sudden, the culture, talk about changing the culture, the culture is the directors. It is the doctors. It is the organizers. I mean, it's not the organizers. It's the governing officials. You give that rider a chance to kind of really... I can't help but see these riders.
I agree with you totally. Yeah. That is the culture. And what change has there been?
Right.
You know, and we issued a report 5 months ago, and the UCI took it so personally that they decided they needed to establish an independent commission to prove that what USADA said about them wasn't accurate. And then Travis and Tiger, USADA's CEO, and I met with one of the commissioners and the lawyer for the commission, and they decided we need to get some more information here. We need to go beyond the scope of what the UCI told us we can look into. And when the independent commission started acting independent, they were no longer a commission because the UCI took away their funding and they said you're over with. So
yeah,
I mean, how do you address that? Nothing's
at one point ASO Tour de France. The costs were actually economically. German TV dropped the tour. There was this one schedule the ASO I was actually involved with it. In 2007, 2008, they had split from the UCI.
That's what they tour
organizer. Split from the UCI completely. Yeah. They're basically working as a nonprofit church status in Switzerland. No transparency, no accountability, and they take in fees for the drug test. They're not working in cooperation with WADA. They're not cooperating with the French. I mean, to imagine that the head of the French doping agency, doping lab, was actually removed because he was too good. I mean, he was. It's the intertwining of corruption is really
incredible. How do we get to the point where the people are exposed? Reed, what's the idea so that the doctors that have been in the sport for 20 years have been doping riders, the team directors, some of them have been in the sport for 20 years, doping riders, are we just going to say, well, because of the Lance Armstrong case, it's all going to change, you know? Isn't fundamental change necessary, and don't we need to know the scope of the problem in the sport?
Well, this is sort of what you know your organization is trying to do is bring to light the fact that the same people who were, you know, doping riders back in the 90s and even 80s, maybe 70s, are still there. They're still the same people who are maybe not the doctors. Some of the doctors now are getting tossed out, but the same team directors, that the people with that point of view, that doping is just part of the sport, it's just something you do. If you do it right, it's not unhealthy. They're still there. So I would say, you know, we can, as journalists, we can do, you know, the best we can at exposing that. But, you know, what can USADA do? What can WADA, the World Anti-Doping Agency, do to, you know, weed out some of that, you know, some of those people?
Yeah.
I mean, I would.
I mean, one of our ideas has been to give amnesty to riders.
Yeah.
To incentivize people to come forward and tell about what happened so that we know the full picture. And so we don't have all these skeletons in the closet that seems to us they're really damaging the sport at this point.
When you talk to the riders, though, I mean, how did you convince them? They didn't have to talk to you. They didn't have to sign those affidavits for your report, did they? I mean, obviously you had some power over them, but you know, some of them were retiring. What do they care? They must have had some kind of
altruistic. Bill's gentle demeanor. I mean, he is a man of integrity, and he's not gonna go after you to screw you. He wants the truth, and the truth is what is the most important.
Well, thanks, Betsy. But what I really think happened is that these guys got tired of living a lie, and so they were at a point where they wanted to unburden themselves. You know, what could USADA offer them? The rules provide for a reduction of sanction, but, you know, how significant is that? Christian Vandeveld, David Zabriskie, George Hincappie, Levi Leipheimer, they're coming forward and putting their name on the dotted line of a sanction form for the very first time and exposed to the world as somebody that used performance-enhancing drugs. So, you know, the sanction reduction is not much in comparison to what they faced. They're going to lose titles. Levi ultimately was terminated from his team. They expected retaliation. That's what everybody experienced. That's what you guys, everybody up here, except for you and I, Reed, experienced that retaliation.
Really?
Yeah, well, that's true.
How much did the federal investigation play into it, where some of these guys were forced to testify if they perjured themselves? Did they really voluntarily come forward? Because
I think that's a great question. I think what the federal investigation did is it gave people the opportunity to tell the truth, and they liked
it. That's a good thing. Yeah.
Yeah, and they realized grand jury
subpoena.
Yeah, right, so. Exactly.
Right. They had to. They had to. But once they'd done it, Tyler said once he did that, and then went to his mother. I mean, and finally told her the truth, which he'd been hiding for years. I mean, that his relationship with his family members.
That's actually the thing that really it. I mean, I've watched writers' depression. Even Pontani, I met him, nice guy. I mean, guy ends up addicted to coke, but really, it's almost self-destructive behavior that's really out of shame. It's kind of like he's
right.
It wasn't like he was. Angry. He actually, he watched the contest of guys who were viewed as heroes, and the guy had a high positive, but he was treated like a criminal. So you have these conflicts of heroes, criminals, and then nobody realized it's kind of like, I'd imagine, I haven't done it, but you think you can get away with murder. You know, I always like to think this Roald Dahl, some of the short stories, where you think you could do it, but your consciousness, consciousness starts to eat at you, and
right.
I think that's what Tyler, that's what Floyd. I mean, I watched Tyler self-destruct, and actually, when Floyd was positive, I knew Floyd. I met him. I sponsored him in 2001. Mm-hmm. He's a nice guy, and I'm like, oh man, don't do it. I mean, when I said don't do what Tyler did tonight, it was literally like, don't go this route because you actually come from a family that loves you. You come from this core of core values.
Right.
People screw up in life, and they all deserve a second chance. And I just think that there's such a psychological cost that nobody has seen.
But that's where
that's a huge point.
We're all flawed individuals, and we all deserve second chances. But it was the deceit, the corruption, the excoriation. From my own personal experience, on a daily basis, every day for 10 years, to say I never lied, I always told the truth. And I was ignored by a lot of people in the media. It took time away from my family, time away from my kids who were small.
Walters. Betsy calls me one morning and she says, oh my God.
And Lance was on The View, and Barbara Walters and Star Jones. It was 2006, NPR, and Alan Abrahamson from the LA Times came out with their stories. They got our depositions. We didn't give it to them from the SEA case that we were dragged into. And Star Jones said, now a wife of a former teammate is saying that you doped. Aren't you just sick of it? She's just a mouth. And Barbara Walters said, aren't you just sick of it, Lance? And I called up Kathy. And this is what I was dealing with on a daily basis. And
it's like, I'm ironing,
and
Barbara Walters is talking about me. Like, I'm some big liar.
Yeah, and I mean, and the fact that, my gosh, Greg was painted as this jealous, hateful person. And maybe to you guys, you think, okay, it's a little name calling, you know, just get over it, deal with it. It went far beyond that. It was, I'm going to try to destroy you. I am going to try to ruin your reputation if you don't go along with it. So it went far beyond just being a flawed individual, because we're all flawed.
But what's amazing to me is that was, I don't think that was across the board with teens. It was so focused. It was so focused in the Postal Service. I mean, it was a few personalities that got together.
Oh. Jan Ulrich, we were in Cape Town, and
let me finish. Betsy was targeted. I mean, it was you did what was right, and
you did.
You got annihilated.
No, but anyone else that Greg has called out for doping, they still shake your hand. They still talk to you. They know. They feel bad about their.
Guys, I have a question about your. I mean, looking back at that, the 10 years that you spent, sort of. I mean, going through hell, really. Do you ever regret opening your mouth? I mean, do you just sometimes think, I wish I had just not said anything and been left alone?
I wish the hospital room incident never happened in a way, but it happened.
Betsy, I asked you about this because we've all read about it, but just tell what happened there and how you happened to be in the room.
Frankie and Lance were really close friends. Frankie was so close with Lance, he had lived with him. We went to go visit Lance after he was diagnosed, after he had brain cancer at Indiana University Hospital. And there was a scheduled meeting with doctors, and so in a conference room among trusted people, the doctors asked a few questions. This was predated HIPAA. I suggested we leave the room because to give Lance his privacy, said that's okay. I said to Frankie, maybe we should leave. Frankie said no. Few banal questions, and then boom, have you ever used performance-enhancing drugs? And it was, he answered nonchalantly, yeah, testosterone, cortisone, growth hormone, EPO, steroids. And I was very upset. Frankie and I were just engaged, and I was convinced, and I'm still convinced, that's how he got his cancer. And I threatened Frankie, I'm going to call off the wedding if you're doing this, because it's just not right. And, you know, for Miss Goody Two Shoes over here, I've just always been anti-drug. And so it did not rest well with me. So that was my introduction into drugs in the sport of cycling. So
and because of that, for 10 years, you were, I'll say persecuted, but you found yourself
just excoriated. And we found it was difficult for Frankie to work in the sport because he was told repeatedly from so many in the industry, you're too controversial. There was one, he had a job with one company, pretty big one, that said you and your wife can keep, you can keep your job if you and your wife keep your mouth shut. And we had just filmed with CBC, which is the Canadian Broadcasting Company, because we live really close to Canada. We thought, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? And so I told Frankie, I graduated from the University of Michigan, and I'm proud to say I'm a stay-at-home mom. And I said, you know what, if worse comes down to worse, I graduated from U of M, I'm smart, I can get a job. God help us, but you could be the stay-at-home dad. but he wanted to work in the sport. I wanted to raise the kids, and well, you know, Frankie's raising the kids too, but you know what I mean. So he said, we'll find a way, we'll just tighten the financial belt. And so the more Lance pushed me, the stronger I'd push him back twice as hard, because I was not going to put up with it. And so I had to be very smart about it, because what made Lance so different than Indurain or Ulrich was that it was a win at all cost. It was keep quiet at all cost and go along with it at all cost. There was no other athlete. He owned part of the team. He cozied up to politicians who helped protect him, whether it was Bill Clinton or Nicolas Sarkozy. He had the help of his sponsors. Nike just didn't care, in my opinion. They turned a complete blind eye. He had USA Cycling turned a blind eye. They didn't care. The UCI,
we're going to come back to them in a minute.
But they had the media, and they had the sponsors. And then that trickled down to the fans. And so what would happen is that people in the media would just take his word for it. Lance would say she's hateful and she's crazy and she's bitter. But as we see in Oprah, he set the record straight, I'm not fat. And so when...
I have that song on my phone.
I am. He got us confused.
He had this bubble that was unseen by anybody, whether it was any, I can't think of any other sports personality, sports celebrity, that was so inoculated like Lance was. And so I just thought, okay, this is what I'm up against. but I've got something he doesn't have, and it's the truth. And so when Travis, who was then general counsel of USADA, called in 2006 to say, I want to talk about Frankie, because Frankie admitted to Juliet McCurve of the New York Times, who was the first journalist in his 12-year career, and to ask him whether or not he ever used a performance-enhancing drug, and this was 6 years after he had retired. So
I think
this
Juliet,
is a story about
Juliet, are you here?
Juliet?
She was here tonight. Is Juliet here? I thought she was here tonight. Okay.
And so when Travis had called and got on the phone with me, I said, you have to be kidding me. And I said, Lance is the biggest fraud in the history of sport, and you're going to go after my husband when he lost his job? Are you crazy? And I had a few choice words for Travis, and the conversation ended. But it was painful. But again, I had to work it smart. And then the journalists who were interested in the truth and wanted the truth, I always thought knowledge is power, and when it gets out there, you're not going to be able to suppress it, because the truth is just too powerful and too big.
So it took, she also asked, but she did ask whether Lance doped as well, right? And yeah. I mean,
and I think Frankie said, well, I don't want to get into that.
So did you want him to come clean at that point, or to tell the truth about
Lance?
Well,
I told, because Juliet was going to do a story on me, which was the woman who stood up to Lance Armstrong, and it never turned out to be that. But I told Frankie, I said, look, I am not going to be one of those wives who stands by your side while you lie. I'm not going to do it. The sport has a problem. Frankie always hated the doping in the sport. He started his career clean, spent the vast majority of his career clean, and ended his career clean, and it cost him his job. And so he said, there's a problem. And so that's why he answered the question honestly. And then what did Pat McQuaid do, who is the head of the UCI? He said, what good is he doing? What does he want to accomplish by saying this? Just wanted to completely ignore anybody who had admitted to doping or had tested positive, who had knowledge of Lance. Pat McQuaid just didn't want to know. He didn't want to know.
I remember Ryder Zanetti, Italian Ryder, went to the dentist, came out, died of a heart attack. And a guy named, it was a team called Amore Vita, which was actually sponsored by the Catholic Church. Amore Vita, Love and Life. And Fanini came out and he just said, you know, it's time we all look at ourselves in the mirror. We're all going to be dead. Riders will be dead by 10 to 50. And the president of the UCI, this is where I get pissed. It's like, not the riders, it's like the boss. Verbruggen just said, hey, if you don't like the sport, get the hell out. You know, that's the response of a guy who's like, oh my God, we're dying here. And so that's really, I think it's important to understand too, Lance was not alone, and Lance is not the first. What I'm saying is that there was a team effort there. It was a masterful job at PR, political, you know, pulling the strings, paying favors, getting favors. But I think what set him up, I don't want to even make this about Armstrong, but set this whole period in cycling apart was that there was payoffs, there were, you know, bribes. And then when you think of that, that means it's not a level playing field. One rider, maybe a few, and I kind of, you know, this is alleged, but I look at the irony that every rider that left that team was positive. Floyd, Tyler, Contador. You got to remember the drug tests, how they're done. UCI, you go in, hasn't changed since I'm cycling, except for the blood test. But you still go in, you pee in a vial, they get separated, the people in it, you know, UCI, a doctor. All it takes is one guy in there that goes, whoop, clip this out, goes to the lab, it's clean or it's dirty. And so, I mean, that's where I look. And I'm no proof of that. But that's where it threw everything into kind of chaos, because it's, you know, I am not seeking out information. I had no vendetta against Armstrong. I actually was big supporter of him. I had everything to gain financially from him succeeding, but I was brought information, and part of it was I was the Tour de France winner and an American, but people within the sport that knew what was going on, the professionals, the teams that are in there, they couldn't stand it, because it wasn't just that there was modesty and I got lucky, I did this. It was, no, I'm better. I train harder, I'm better. And as a pro, I know I've raced 14 years, bullshit. That's, every rider is dedicated, everybody trains. Mm-hmm. I would say there's a variance of 1% of training dedication, if that. I raced 100 races a year, and I can't figure out how you could train harder than 100 days, 120 days of racing a year. So the myth and the fallacy and the kind of the story was denigrating to everybody else and prop one person up. And that's really, I thought, was really hard for me to take. And in fact, I heard about the hospital room. You don't even know this, but October 1999. So it's bizarre. Like, for me, it was like this one little information here, little bit here, and it's like, you know, I will not say that guy's a doper. I question wattage. I believe in there's science can actually, science and profiling and cooperation with law officials, you can actually get a sport that's legitimate. And you could actually look at it and go, this is great. And this is not just a cycling sport, the problem. This is, goes to every world-class sport.
But see, if we were to make doping in sport a federal crime, like it is in Italy, in Germany, in France, it would be completely different, because nobody wants to face jail time.
Yeah. Well, if you made it,
what do you, but you're not, what do you think of that idea? I mean, should it be a federal
crime? I don't know. It seems like every time we got a problem, we want to criminalize it, right? So,
it's different than addiction. I think this is different. This is different addiction. This is actually
right.
Drug trafficking.
But I think there's
yeah. Well, you're trying to make money. You're taking somebody else's money by drugging.
But you got it. Riders, I've watched it. A rider that, you know, you see these studies of social pressure. A guy single by himself would never choose to do that. You get him with 30 people, the social pressure is incredible. So you've got to give those riders that one chance, come clean, second time you're out, and it's tied to financial costs.
There's got to be a financial
cost. I want to hear about the UC. You said some things to me, and if you could just talk a little bit about, you did the investigation. The USADA had to take over. Federal government was out there and all of a sudden dropped the case. This has been going on for years. There's the deposition in the SCA case, so there's some work being done. And then you go ahead, you guys do the findings. You confront Lance a couple times, and you also have to deal with UCI. Tell us how that worked and what happened and the roadblocks that you got along the way.
Sure.
Because I want to get to, where do we go?
Yeah, no, it's, and I think this ties into a lot of what's been said, because I think the ultimate tragedy would be if this whole scenario is viewed as the Lance Armstrong affair. And that's how the UCI wants everyone in this room to view it. Their view is now, and it was Pat McQuaid in his press conference, is that Lance Armstrong has no place in cycling. And they want you to believe that, look, here's the problem over here. It was Lance Armstrong. Okay. Now, look over here. It's a different era. It's the same people involved, the same problems we've always had in the sport. And what UCI did in our case, and I won't have time to list it all, But we brought the case under U.S. rules and under UCI rules. We clearly had jurisdiction over an American athlete to bring the case. We went on for a month, and when Lance Armstrong's lawyers filed a case in federal court here in Austin, Texas, and took the position that Lance had only agreed to play by UCI rules, not by U.S. rules, UCI dramatically changed it in about face, changed their position, and said, that's right. That's the position. And they asked us to drop the case. And they didn't just ask us. They demanded that USADA drop the case. We work with a lot of international federations around the world, and we cooperate and work effectively with those international federations. And when we have a case against an athlete, and we ask them for all the test results for that athlete, they're turned over by the IAAF and other, the International Federation of Track and Field and other federations. We asked the UCI for the information on Lance Armstrong, and they said no. He hasn't consented to you having that information.
Wow.
So unfortunately, even in the Armstrong case isn't the only case where we've confronted that sort of an approach by the UCI. The UCI, as we've talked about, went after our witnesses during the case. They told everybody we've asked USADA to investigate. But then they go out in the media and undercut the witnesses that we're trying to get to cooperate with us and impugn their integrity.
Oh, yeah. I forgot, scumbag is what the president said.
And then we'll get to the end. They announce that Lance Armstrong has no place in cycling. They accept our sanction. Why? Because now the world knows, and it's out there on the internet. They had no choice. They accept the USADA sanction, and Pat McQuaid, at the end of his public statement, says, "And I want to thank the riders that came forward after he put him down for months. I want to thank the riders for coming forward after he had put him down, knowing that Lance had synthetic EPO in his urine samples. So I want to thank the riders." And then turns around and has a further discussion with reporters within the hour, calls Floyd Landis and Tyler Hamilton, the guys that were willing to come forward with the truth, scumbags.
Yeah.
They are nothing but scumbags. And with that sort of attitude and the leadership of the sport, I'm not sure that we're going to change the culture.
No, I don't think you will unless UCI gets actually cyclists and order guys got to get rid of them.
I'm just going to use a couple of examples, and we're going to run out of time, unfortunately. But there was money paid to UCI. They've admitted that money came from the team, the Lance Armstrong team, to UCI, right?
Correct.
And you've asked for information on that?
To UCI. We've asked for information. They've publicly told the media they have a file. They're willing to provide it to anybody. But I guess we're not anybody because they haven't provided it.
So a payment was made by Lance to the governing body.
Right.
And they've never explained what that was for.
Well, they've said it was to clean up sport.
Well, I thought they bought a little machine that about $80,000.
Yeah, they said
$15 million budget, maybe.
They said that what they used it for was a Sysmex machine for blood controls.
Okay.
Now, you're
that's
only seeing one of the payments. Those are just, that's just
can't
who knows to individuals. It's that everyone's
no, that's what I do want to just say that in the year 2000, I was told that after Lance's first positive, and I testified under oath to this in the SCA deposition, that $500,000 was paid to Hein Verbruggen to make that positive test go away. And that wasn't money sent to the UCI.
And that wasn't the first time we heard that about a rider.
And that was,
money
was
sent.
The first guy.
That was Julian DeVries, which I'm curious if Bill ever, did you make any efforts to talk to him?
Talk to who?
Julian DeVries, the person who told Kathy the team mechanic on the U.S. Postal Service.
I haven't spoken with Julian DeVries. And there's look, this is what the independent commission was supposed to look at, right? And when we started telling the independent commissioners that they ought to ask for things like a promise from the UCI not to retaliate, well, I guess those two terms were too onerous for the UCI.
But the key, in my opinion, is that the moment that Armstrong's side paid the $500,000 to Hein Verbruggen, they each knew enough to destroy the other. I did say. It's
my
opinion.
There's a lot of lawyers in here. They know that you have to say allegedly before.
Well, they've already tried to sue us twice, but yeah. They never came to court with us. And the other thing is, I really think all this strange behavior by the UCI, by Verbruggen. Verbruggen's quote that he knows that Lance never, never, never used drugs. Then he already knew at that point there was synthetic opio in it.
Actually, I'm going to, might not sound right, but Armstrong actually is a pawn in...
Well, that's what I said, to the UCI.
Yeah. He's a pawn.
There's a big game here.
Yeah.
That was all set up. I don't think Lance came up with the thought to pay Hein Verbruggen $500,000 to make his positive go away. I don't know. I'm just saying.
There's other stories in cycling that, you know,
years
you trace
earlier.
It to a bank account, you can't say it. But, it's like some of these are fairly good stories. And so, but there was, say, a positive in 95, which I'm going to go into it because there's, you know, I'm a journalist and I wrote for Le Monde. So I have journalistic privilege. Thank God I did. I mean, but there was an alleged positive in 95, alleged payment to government, the Cycling Federation officials. 97, there's a rumor of a world championship backdated prescription. So that's where I'm.
And what needs to happen is that everything needs to come out in the open. I mean, rumors are rumors. We can't do much with those. But what the world was promised was an independent commission that would look into these things, and the UCI hasn't delivered on that, and they need to. It's for the good of the sport.
But I hope other federations, governing bodies, Major League Baseball, Bud Selig. It was a joke with Sammy Sosa and Mark McGuire, and they just turned a complete blind eye to that. And so this has to be a teachable moment. It has to be a lesson for all sports. Well, you can't just turn a blind eye.
I don't have detailed knowledge of Major League Baseball's testing program, but they have had, I mean, Manny Ramirez and, a number of others that have tested positive
recently. Last few years.
Yeah, recently.
But why doesn't the public care? Well, why don't we care? Yeah. We're supposed to care.
Some people do.
I want to,
something else that was striking that you told me, and I think there's people in this room who would like to know, because the implication is that USADA went after Lance and suspended him for life, took away all of his yellow jerseys, and there was a behind-the-scenes discussion about that how he ended up with a life banishment from the sport. Can you tell a little bit about that, and then I want to get to that last question and then some questions from the audience.
The key question that we have for every rider is, are you willing to come in and help us to clean up the sport? And we had 11 former teammates that signed on to that program, and we offered Lance the same opportunity to come in, be truthful, tell us the sport, and then the rules would be applied to him as they were to these other riders. Lance is the only American rider that refused that request to come in and meet with us and be truthful and honest and take the opportunity to clean up the sport. Had he done that? The reason that we could go back and seek disqualification of results from 1998 is because of the subversion of the legal system. If he had been open and honest with us and come in, there wouldn't have been a basis to do that. So his situation in sport would have been considerably different.
So would he have kept any of those yellow jerseys?
Well, if we had, yeah, he would have kept five of them. He would have kept five yellow jerseys and most likely would not have been banned for life.
So what do? We only have a few minutes before we open this up to questions. The sport is trashed right now. Do you trust anyone? Can you trust the governing body? No.
No.
Right? The riders, I don't know whether they feel a deterrent now because USADA and other countries are out there acting like they should?
I think they do. I think the biological passport system has made an impact in the sport. And I really think what the riders did, 11 teammates breaking the omerta, the wall of silence, has had a real impact in the sport. I think the riders want a clean sport, and more and more of them are willing to take risks like testifying for us, and I think take risks like riding clean.
How's Frankie feeling? He's riding, right?
No, he doesn't. He's too old.
Oh, I thought he was out.
Can I tell
so he married a young wife. So. That's right.
Yeah,
so.
No, but he, since USADA and WADA's inception, there's absolutely no excuse. But it's going to be up to the team management. It's going to be up to the UCI, because the UCI ultimately will decide who... If we look at the past, because there are some riders out there who are implicated, who are still riding, never been proven guilty, I think everybody has to come clean. As far as today goes, because I was asked the question by somebody, what should happen to those who admit to any doping violations or if they test positive? There's no excuse. Now that we have USADA and WADA, there's no excuse whatsoever. I'm kind of like Greg. One strike and two strikes and you're out.
Kathy, you've come all this way. You've survived all this, and there's got to be a little vindication, even though it's not personal or you didn't want it to be personal. You're vindicated a little bit on taking the stand and being beside Greg and him taking a stand. The only thing I've ever read about your husband is that he was outspoken against drugs. And here's a guy who was a three-time winner of the Tour de France, and he's just been made miserable because he spoke out against drugs. That's his crime.
But I don't think people know that Greg spoke out in the 80s. The day after Greg won the Tour de France in 89, there was a quote in the LA Times. Front-page story about Greg talking about doping. I don't know anybody who wins the Tour de France and then talks about doping that day. You know, it doesn't happen anymore. But Greg went to the UCI in 1985 and asked them if they could please start blood testing.
This one.
What was it?
I think I remember it was with a helmet loss. So
yeah,
I
thought that was 85.
Heroes, no,
85 or 86.
86 so.
But he said, is there any way we can do blood testing in professional cycling? They said to him, it's against their religion. We were in Milan.
Against many religions, so it's...
Yeah, and I think that... No, but I think the thing that...
It was against
really,
Major League Baseball's union's religion.
Yeah,
too.
Exactly.
No, but when you're a clean cyclist and you want to race clean, you want everybody, you know? You want to know the controls are real. But, okay, to get back to what happened to us the last decade... What I feel so bad about is the thrashing of Greg and his reputation. He'll be embarrassed, but
I'm a grown up. I can.
But we've been married for almost 33 years. That he has been portrayed as a jealous person, a sore loser,
sour grapes.
All of this, it wasn't about that at all. It never was. He is not jealous of anyone. And the one thing, you know, everybody says, oh, you lose all your money, but at least you've got your reputation. Well, he lost his reputation. And he didn't do it because he did anything wrong. He did right. And it makes me so angry to think of that. It's like I talked to our 25-year-old who pointed out that he was 12 when this began for him. And our daughter was 9 when Julian DeVries told us the extent of the doping on Postal Service. They were standing with me when Julian told us everything. They were in the car when we decided we couldn't go along with it. We packed the car up and we drove. We were supposed to go to Alpe d'Huez. We left the Tour de France and we never came back.
Well, that
it
is,
made us
I'm
physically ill.
Tour de France, of course, an American wins. Who do the journalists want to get a quote from? Me. So all I could think of, to be true to myself, is like I just said, I think the only thing I said that time is unbelievable. It's the only thing that kind of made it not believable.
We didn't know how to handle it. We did not know how to handle all the information that we'd been given. But what my son Scott said before we went to the airport, he said, you know, Mom, I was 12 when this started. And he said probably every single day of school, excuse my language, he said, somebody said to me, your dad's a jealous piece of S-H-I-T. That's what our kids live with this whole time. And all that happened was their dad just said, I'm not going along with this. But he'd done that his whole life.
But I think what I find, and I know it through some litigation, but there was an actual army to plant stuff, feed farms. It was not just, because I actually from 2001 to 2007, I gave 5 interviews. That's out of hundreds a year. And the one I said, you know, it's kind of quaint now. I'm disappointed you see him for it. And honestly, this isn't about Armstrong, but the actions of Armstrong, it became about Armstrong. He made it about Armstrong. He made it about, you know, I actually do not like bullies. And I'll usually get crushed to the ground before I get bullied. And that's how I felt. And so I had a little, but I actually had a gun at my head. You know, it wasn't that I could even just, I literally got shut out of racing. Actually,
you had to go away for this myth to
attempt.
Continue.
I actually remember there was an attempt to actually erase my name from cycling. Graham Watson, who's a famous cycling photographer, my daughter goes on to it. Somebody tweeted that he had a whole archive of cycling photos. So you had, you know, Indoran Merckx, and you go to my site. and this has affected my kids. It was labeled Fool. But every name, it wasn't just Greg Grunt. I was, you know, Fool. Now, he happens to be in partners with Armstrong. He keeps his archive here. But these guys profited, and not only did they profit, they went along with, it's actually, I don't get it, it's wrecked, it's criminal behavior that happened within this deal. And it wasn't just a simple, I have my opinion, they have their opinions. I would have loved that, just, you know, it probably not gone anywhere. Just, I had, you know, an opinion. I mean, you've seen Ferrari, which I explained before, Ferrari wasn't new. I mean, he destroyed so many lives. And so for somebody who is, I said, preaching that he's just better and stronger and trains more, same thing you see in Ferrari, which honestly, he was a magician. But he was, I mean, Ferrari was the type, his own daughter was a triathlete. He juiced her to the gills. They caught him in a triathlon pacing his daughter. He had knee-high socks on, glasses. That's the mentality of Ferrari. It's cheat at all costs. Cheat to win at all costs. And, you know, I think there's a lot of riders truly that never anticipated getting the sport that did this. And I'm hopeful that riders want to change. I think the racers are going to do it. I'm not optimistic with UCI staying involved in the doping. I don't. Most of the big scandals have been criminal. Festina, it's always been police because it's traffic. And one thing I just want to state, and I hear this argument about legalizing it. And legalize doping. Let everybody, it's a level playing field. Now, drugs are very powerful. There's FDA. You have, whatever, hundreds of countries. And what you guys don't know, I got a video that I got from a guy, a writer. And it's like a heroin den. It's an IV butterfly guys digging through vials, breaking them open, and it's just this big, long syringe. And it is not, it's not one rider taking an aspirin. It's not taking, you know, what everybody thinks. But I always look at it, think of the complications. I know that Manzano, this is an example. Manzano was a Spanish rider. He was one of the first to really expose what was happening. But he passed out on the stage. And the director
on the road.
On the road, in the tour. And his director came up to him and said, the guy's dying. You don't talk about this.
Don't tell him when you get to the ER what you're on.
So he goes to the ER, and again, the guy had bad blood. It was either that or hemopure.
Something.
Got a dry mouth. But anyways, he came out and he said, imagine the antidepressants and their withdrawal, and it could throw people into suicidal positions, but they were handing antidepressants out like they were candy. I mean, it's not just testosterone. It's not just growth hormone, which is already a lot, but it's antidepressants. It's all this mixture, and these riders have no clue. They get fired, go cold turkey, boom. But Manzano at the hospital, his director came up again and said, you talk, you're done. And this is the guy's dying. And so there's, that's kind of what I, those are the stories I go, whoa, that's not worth it.
Reed, any final thoughts before we turn it over to the audience to grill you a little?
Sure. I think that, I mean, one thing I'd say is as a journalist covering this, I think I got started a little late at the Journal. We didn't have, the Wall Street Journal didn't even have sports coverage when we first started looking into this, but it was not difficult to figure out what the truth was about cycling, about Lance Armstrong. I mean, the truth was really out there in the open, and writing about it was difficult. It was tricky. But, I mean, from the very beginning, the editors that I worked with at the Journal understood, I mean, based on our reporting, based on what we gathered, that there was doping was rampant in the sport. It was very clear that Armstrong was doping. It was clear that the UCI, there were conflicts of interest there. I mean, that was just, we understood that. And there was never a question of should we write about this or should we not write about this. It was, you know, we need to figure out how to write about it, how we can, you know, get stuff that we can actually put in the paper. And it was a lot of work. It took years to, you know, get to the point where we had, you know, we broke the story about Floyd Landis, and that, you know, I guess I'm thankful that I wasn't under the pressures of some sports reporters out there who, you know, had to weigh whether they should expose this and lose access, you know, or maybe lose their reputation in the sporting press. You know, that was never an issue at the Journal. Now the Journal does have sports, you know, a pretty good sports section. I would hope that, you know, we still wouldn't weigh those things. I don't think we do. But that's sort of my, you know, view is on covering the story, if that's something I can add.
Yeah, that's very few journalists. I know a lot of people in cycling. It is that have been fired because they've written something that goes against the sport, and it's difficult.
It seemed like a lot of journalists thought, well, if I just put, there's a cloud of suspicion over Lance's head, but he denies doping, that, okay, they mentioned it, then they were safe. And it was always, let's follow any accusation with all the great work that he does through his foundation, which was another thing he used, I feel, to protect himself from answering questions.
But I also want to just make clear, it wasn't just about showing that some guy took drugs. I mean, that's not,
no.
To me, that's not a story. The story was that it was so vast, and there were real victims. I mean, in talking to you guys and many other people, it was just the human toll was so evident that, you know, that combined with the fact that, you know, look, as a journalist, it's a fascinating conspiracy, a fascinating business story. You know, it was just something.
But we were ignored. The Le Mans and I were essentially ignored because people believed.
Well, if you hadn't been ignored, then I never would have written any stories.
That's what I was saying. There were a lot of really dedicated journalists that just got shut down. And
yeah.
They were trying to do their job, and it's like, I mean, I kind of laughed that I got into kind of a lawsuit to defend my bike company. And, you know, I had money, you know, some assets, and I thought, oh, God, it's a no-brainer. This is extortion. It's tortious interference, and I ran out of money, basically. I couldn't even get to trial. And spending money on lawyers, and then I only smiled when Nowitzki was taunted. So I go, okay, at least, you know, I felt prey to a very strong. When I see a Department of Justice investigator, FDA investigator, being taunted by
Or the influence, and then we just thought, how did we ever have a hope? The organization was too big and too powerful for us.
I was trying to keep my business alive. I actually love cycling, and you know, it was my life since I got into it 14 years old. And you know, it's been but it's been almost a clear line for me. I can't really be involved, but I believe cycling is an incredible sport. I really believe that the riders do want to change. It should be the riders. It should be the teams. They should get rid of the UCI. I don't care about the IOC. I'm sorry. We actually have actually destroyed the sport because of an event every 4 years. I never raced the Olympics. The Tour de France was itself by itself. And when you think about it, the World Championship Olympics, what, 10 guys get to go from the U.S. from cycling? And we're letting guys in Switzerland destroy the sport. And I'm saying, I kind of made a little plea to people, you know, put your money where your mouth is. We don't, the idea of a governing body, and I'm going to talk to you this later, but is an antiquated system. I mean, organizers, we had MS-150 this weekend, 17,000 people. No UCI was involved. UCI just made the rule, this passing rule, that anybody who's a competitor has a UCI license, if they competed in the MS-150, they will get suspended from the UCI, the USA Cycling. And I say, I mean, this sport's way more powerful than a couple, bunch of suits in Switzerland and a bunch of guys in Colorado Springs. Not these guys. These guys.
The good guys.
But I just would love to see, I mean, it's organizers put on events. They need insurance. That's why USA Cycling exists. Shit, you get, like, Costco. You know, you amortize everybody who becomes a member, and you find alternative ways. And so that's where the sport needs to go back to the people who really love cycling. That's the big growth as I see these grand fondos, these cycling events. They're basically races that have 10,000 people.
So. That's just going to grab you.
Right. Okay, we're going to give the audience a shot at it.
I'm going to give some.
Oh, wow. I'll start here and I'll work around. Let's keep these as short as you can. We've got a few people.
Is this on?
It's on.
After reading Tyler's book and David Walsh's book, just first off, I want to say that for the people who haven't read those, everybody up there is a hero because they stood up to tyranny for, what, 10, 12, 15 years. So I have one quick question for each of you. Oakley threatened you, didn't they? And then
Stephanie did.
It wasn't from Oakley?
She was employed by Oakley. When she threatened me, I don't know if she was still employed by Oakley.
Oh, okay. And then Trek went after you, didn't they?
Yeah. I mean, I had,
I will answer.
Right. And then for Bill, I've heard one rumor that Nike also contributed to a payoff to help high test results. Have you ever followed up on that, or is anybody checking into that?
I don't have, and I can't confirm that. I don't have, can't talk about open things or anything, but I can't confirm.
Let's keep it to one question per person.
All right,
Ed, why don't you go behind you, and then I'll come over here. I'll come around.
Can you hear me? I want to thank you all for great comments. This conference says sports and media, and I think some of the media is based on the investigative journalism component. But I think there's a big part of the media that has not been talked about. And I'd like to have your collective opinion about the participation, I feel like even the accomplice component of OLN versus NBC Universal that feeds these stories every year of a great race, competition, pure, and then to find out weeks after the race that it's tainted. And there's somebody that has to quit either during or after the race. They made millions of dollars. In a sense, the entire cycling industry is dependent to some degree on NBC Universal's promotion of the Tour de France. And yet I don't hear anything about discussions with Stephen Burke, who's the president of NBC Universal, or anybody at Comcast. What's your opinion of their responsibility to not promote a sport that's tainted until they assist in cleaning it up?
Reed, you answer.
Reed wants to say something.
Is that Reed?
No, Betsy wanted me to say something.
Yeah,
but my point is you have to differentiate between, you know, journalism and entertainment.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. Is there a responsibility I see, you know, these sports broadcasters is that there's an entertainment component to those networks. And I think that's how they view it. So, you know, I think that for them, it's when it comes to entertainment, it's about the bottom line. It's about, you know, do these scandals affect the bottom line? And I think if people stop watching because of the doping, then they're going to have to address that.
But look at Fox and the NFL. They've been instrumental.
I agree, and I understand that entertainment, and it is kind of like, I actually look at the Tour de France, they're organized, they put on the best event. You leave it up to the UCI that's supposed to implement this with the anti-doping agencies. But I know in 2007 when German TV pulled out, other TV broadcasts were pulling out of the tour. And that flipped management to say, we're leaving our future towards a few handful of people at the UCI. And I do believe it can make a difference. I understand the entertainment value. And it is, if it falls apart, but it'd be, you know, if for even for NBC's investment into it, they could influence ASO to, you know, it could influence a whole bunch of people to go get rid of this group. Let's work with WADA, USADA, and figure out the right problem.
Well, I think it would be great if I think with the German TV, that was a unique situation. I think It would be great if there was more altruism in, you know, in these networks. I'm just saying that they could use a little kick in the butt from, you know. Well, that is our job. I mean, what we, you know, you talked about the helmet issue. Well, it didn't start with Fox. You know, it started with you know, newspapers really writing stories about it, and then it trickled up. It became such a huge, loud issue that they had to address it. And, you know, so, yeah, I mean, it is our job, and I think the print sports media probably, my point is, probably has more responsibility. But it would be great if television network executives had a little bit more, you know, viewed their jobs as a little bit more.
I guess you're right. It's maybe they're not journalists, but the journalists can. I do find it, it's hard to hear commentators ignore facts that are out there.
Yeah.
It's like that's, I can understand the, but it all comes down to, I mean, purchasing ads. So you have all these sponsors that are backing certain riders. They're going to buy TV ads. They don't want negative stuff about their riders, so it's this vicious cycle that.
But it goes back to money, right? I mean, yeah. When NBC Universal or OLN and then Versus, when they broadcast the Tour de France, they're also making business deals with the teams and the sponsors and the riders. So it's all interconnected with money. And when you have that kind of a situation, you're not going to have independent media, right? They're all.
I'll forget it if I don't say it. But I was here at the Formula One racer in Austin in November, and it was really enlightening. I met Bernie Ecclestone, and I always compared Verbruggen to Bernie Ecclestone, wanting to own F1. But what's interesting about F1 and Bernie, and it gave me a whole different kind of thought process, the racing became so boring. I mean, it was technical advances and huge, basically, mechanical doping within car racing, and they realized it's bad for business, and so they became very restrictive, and they have all these limits and all this idea that car racing Formula One is all free market full of technology. It's bad for business, and they realized they need to keep the competition level. And it was, I always saw it as kind of this intertwined deal that is kind of incestuous. I think the riders, the teams, they could do a lot to assure the public that there is transparency. We're going to work on watch. We're going to work on opening everything up to WADA, and we're going to work with the anti-doping. We're going to work with the police. The riders and the organizers could control it, and the sport could be. It's a great sport. I mean, it could be thriving. And anyways, I didn't mean to. It's kind of like the sport needs to control that product that they're delivering to, if you think.
We can go to the next one real quick.
Thank you very much. This is for Greg. I'm Rick Gibb from Bell News, and thank you all for being here. Greg, what's your view on the biological passport and how that's addressing cycling and drug testing?
I think it's a good, important part. I'm always kind of, everybody hears this watch. But with biological passport, with today's technology, I've been using SRM system since 93. It's the same system, but self-calibrating. Ultimately, how much oxygen you take in, how much energy you put out goes right out of the pedal. Cycling's a unique sport that actually can measure the true potential of an athlete. Running has strides, length, it has so many, swimming has so much technique, but cycling is very mechanical. I'm not talking speed, but actual energy out of the crank. I actually proposed this to the tour. They split from the UCI. they were going to implement this. And it's actually, the crazy thing for me is there's technology. There's the potential to actually fix the sport right now. You do that with biological. You do that with the drug testing. But I say you can actually see blood doping. You can see somebody who's boosting themselves. And there's a couple good
through
articles.
Through the Watt output.
Yep.
Well, can I ask Bill a question about that? Maybe just take your question. Because we wrote a story about the biological passport. This was a few years ago. That, you know, one of the issues with it is the UCI was actually running the program. And right. I found out that they have an independent group that looks at the test results. They don't know the names of the people who were looking at the results, but they had said there were 5 positive tests. Mm-hmm. And they handed it up to the UCI. And then there were no positives. So they were sort of, these scientists who were looking at the numbers were wondering, well, what happened to these positive tests that we passed up? So, you know, Bill, is that, so the problem is obvious, right? That at some point they were being stopped from coming forward. So has that system been reformed, or are there still issues like that with the biological passport?
Well, let's deal with the evidence from the Armstrong case. Lance, obviously, we know about the suspicious test results from early in his career. He comes back, does his comeback, and from what the UCI has now acknowledged just this year, they took blood from Lance in 2009 and in the tour. They took blood from Lance in 2010, but the last time that they analyzed it, sent it to their passport committee, was May of 2009. Before the tour. So he finishes on the podium of the tour, and nobody ever looks at that data. So look, you can spend millions of dollars on a biological passport program, which they do, and say that you're a champion of clean sport, but you gotta look at the data. And it's not just the Armstrong case. In 2010, WADA had an independent observer team at the Tour de France, and they criticized they had an opportunity to look at the blood data, and they criticized how few tests were directed towards the riders that had suspicious values, and even several riders of interest didn't even get any tests. So there's a little bit of a concern about somebody being asleep at the switch, and just not looking at the information that they're paying so much money to get. Last thing on Lance Armstrong, a lot of good blood data in 2009, our expert opined it was evidence of doping. 2010, we had some data, and he also felt that there was evidence of doping there, but the samples taken from Lance, the blood samples ended right before the tour went into the mountains. So we didn't have the nice full picture like we had in 2009. You just see things like that, and you go, "What's going on here?"
They didn't even take it. They didn't even take the test at all.
They stopped. The sampling stopped. You know, relatively early in the tour for Lance in that tour.
Question up here.
Yeah, it was profound watching Lance go through those series of admissions with Oprah there at the beginning of the interview. And I'm curious for your collective speculation as to why he went through those profound admissions, you know, when he answered yes, 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 over and over again. It was stunning. And I'm curious to hear your collective speculation as to why, when he arrived at the hospital incident, he refused to validate that account of yours, Betsy. And but what would you speculate were the personal advantages, the legal advantages, the political, the financial, why would he stop short of that hospital account?
There were advantages into not admitting that it happened because, let's face it, he had Craig Nichols, his doctor, who signed an affidavit and said that he never asked Lance if he had ever used anything. I don't know about you, but when I go to the doctor, one of the very first questions I'm asked is, what medications are you on? Do you drink? Do you smoke? But for a cancer patient, he was never asked any of those questions. So I think Lance is protecting, first and foremost, Craig Nichols, his doctor, and he's protecting Stephanie McElvain, who went before the grand jury. Presumably, in my opinion, I don't think she told the truth because she has a pattern of protecting Lance, and then Lance returns the favor. So there were too many legal implications. And throughout, I just finished watching Oprah 2 weeks ago. He cherry-picked the truth. And I think he should be lauded for wanting to tell the truth and for saying that he was a cheat. However, he did not come forward. And this is where Lance could still be part of the solution, but he refuses to. And instead, he wants to be viewed as part of the victim. And I have said, and I told him, I will be your biggest supporter if you come forward. And he hasn't taken me up on the offer.
Hi.
Question here.
It seems to me that part of the problem with the culture of doping and cycling is the willful ignorance that a lot of riders take. That I think some of them want to dope to win, and I think others just simply close their eyes and don't ask any questions. Is USADA in any type of a position to influence like a standard of care or some sort of standardized method for accepting medicine and syringes and whatnot from doctors? Okay. I don't think I said that very clear, did I? Is there some sort of procedure that we could mandate that riders follow before they swallow a pill or take an injection or a vitamin shot or whatever? Is there anything we can do to help them be more aware of what they are taking?
It shouldn't take, I hate to say this, but I raced 14 years and never had an IV blood glucose drip. You need that if you're in a war, unless you need that if you're absolutely heat stroke, and but your gastric emptying is pretty quick. You drink a liter, you get through it.
There are some policies like that. Some of the teams have instituted no needle policies. The UCI even has a no needle policy. Don't know how they enforce it, some of those things, the injection of vitamins, it made it easier for the guys to dope. When you're getting an injection, you're being told it's a vitamin, but it's happening every day, and you start to believe that injection is necessary to compete in the sport, you know, that's a first step into doping. So, and as Greg said, it's not necessary. Maybe it is when everybody else is doing it, but if I think there are a lot of steps like that that could be taken.
I think it was Mike Lashen who said, you know, told me one of the things is, you know, needle marks should be looked at. You get a drug test because it's honestly, when I race, the Tour de France always had a race doctor. So if you're sick, you know, I get sick, they call up the doctor, they come here, they look at me, here's antibiotics. I'm not good enough, I go home. I mean, that's what most people do. You get sick at work and you don't go up to the head office and then they lay you down and put about 20 drugs and you go get back to work. Take some time off. And that's all these vitamin injections. I say I did three and it was with the doctor. There's medical care that needs to happen, but to think that you have to take an injection, so much as a placebo effect in the past, like give somebody some water, they probably will probably race better mentally, but they won't physically be doing better. Today's a different deal, though.
Question over here.
Yeah, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about Team Slipstream, and do you think it's making an impact, and do you think it will be lasting?
Are you talking to me? I think there's a big effort for. There is some really good efforts by teams out there to race clean, and I think the risk. I mean, I think the risk for bodders, say, is huge if they have a positive. I have a friend, Eric Boyer, who ran companies. I know zero doping policy. He had a rider positive, so you can't control every rider. They can go behind, you know, they see their horse doctor, the veterinarian, and that's what was very famous. Famous cycling doctor was a horse, basically a veterinarian. But I think there's some really positive movement. Yes, you might have a different opinion, but I think I like what Bodders is doing.
And I'll jump on the slipstream question as well. Obviously, there were four individuals from that team, Jonathan Bodders and then Tom Danielson, Christian Vandeveld, and David Zabriskie, that were witnesses in the case. The reason they were witnesses in the case is because they have a policy of encouraging their riders, if they're questioned by anti-doping authorities, come forward and tell the truth. And the riders are told they won't be terminated for telling the truth. That's a omerta fighting policy that we need in cycling, and too many teams don't have a policy like that. They find out that somebody told the truth to anti-doping, and like Levi Leipheimer, they get terminated. So you know there's some real good things that Slipstream is doing, and that one was very important to our investigation.
We'll do probably one or two more, and then we'll let you go. Go ahead.
Really quickly, it's great having a real Tour de France American winner here.
But I would have preferred to have Armstrong seven tours. Tour de France wins. I mean, for me, for the sport and everything, it's. I mean.
Yeah, ask the question. We don't know what that
is. I just want to make that clear. I don't rejoice over Armstrong being ripped over seven tours.
Which leads to the question. So we've mentioned a couple names: Hine, Pat, Lance, Ferrari. Is it that simple to just remove those individuals, or do we need a much bigger shift in the thinking so that it's not UCI?
Well, if we remove the management at the UCI, I think that will contribute to a shift. And that would change things greatly.
Without separating the drug testing from the UCI, it will never work. I mean, you can't have it. It's got to be out of Switzerland for one. It's that's what I mean. Yeah, these women are really tough on me.
And we only mentioned a few names, but there are many more names that probably are worthy of mention, but many that aren't known. And so, you know, a full opportunity for that information to get out there in the public domain, I think, is important, and that's what USADA has been advocating.
I guess that's your job.
Yeah. Do one here.
I was just wondering if you guys thought that if there's anything meaningful that we as fans can contribute to helping the solution. We talked a little bit about what happened with the German TV and how that could, you know, maybe happen in this country some way, but is there anything else that we can do to help reach?
I would say just don't buy the products of the people who support the dopers.
I'd say if you race, don't take a USA Cycling license out this year. Maybe next year till they remove doping from the governing body. That's what I would recommend. Hit them where it hurts. They did that to me.
We're going to do one more.
Last question. So yeah.
It better be good.
It'll be short and good, hopefully. Thanks, McGants. This is great. Has anyone, whether it's John Burke or the executives from NBC or ESPN or Discovery, has anyone apologized? Come back to you.
I had Harry Smith I did Rock Center. He was really the only journalist who said, "I'm sorry, we didn't do enough." And I thought that was really great of him. And so as far as...
sports journalist, though, like, Walsh couldn't have been the only guy who saw that two-speed racing going on.
No, Pierre Ballester, but he lost his job at L'Equipe. I mean, you had Damien Rossio, you had Stéphane Lindard from Le Monde, and the French know the sport, and so they were on it. But even Pierre will say that there were a lot of journalists who, even in Europe, just wanted to toe the party line. They just wanted to, they didn't want to ruffle, you know, what is the word?
Ruffle feathers.
The feathers. But, you know, I want to say, and I'll end it, Lance, when he did call me and Frankie, he said he was sorry. And in that conversation, I thought, I really felt a sincerity that I had never seen from him before. Sorry is only a word. No, and I don't. But I don't want to check. All I wanted to do. No. Let me finish, Greg. All I wanted to do on this trip to Austin was to see Lance for 5 minutes, but he said he didn't trust me, and I'll leave it at that.
Well, I just want to say you tried to get a hold of me before Oprah too, and I think a few others, and I made it a little more skeptical. I'm all for forgiveness, and I would, you know, support Lance.
Let's just say we had lunch with Floyd Landis today.
Hold on.
We're okay with forgiveness.
But I have to say that there's a manipulative personality there that is, that was, I mean, for me, it was, okay, you know, sorry for what? I mean, admit to me what happened, the collusion and that, and that would make me, you know, a little bit kind of, you know, a little bit more empathetic. I look at it as pure manipulation, so you can go on Oprah and say, oh, talk to Greg, I apologize to him, validating his remorse. I haven't seen that, and if he was really apologetic, he'd have come after the interview. He was cutting a deal with the government for the whistleblower case. That's what the whole deal, I believe that he thought that he was, again, you know, somehow he'd convince everybody that in the government that take it easy on him. That's my opinion. I mean, I might be wrong. She knows Armstrong a lot longer. I don't really know him.
Well, it was just in that phone call, I did feel that he put his foot in the pool of humanity, and then he thought, this is too icky, and he yanked it out, and he went back.
I want to believe there's a part of Armstrong that is.
No, but he went back to being, he's in fight mode now. And so now he's in fight mode, and like I said, he could still be a part of the solution, but he can't cherry pick the truth. He has to tell the whole truth.
Yeah.
And I'll be his biggest supporter.
I believe everybody is entitled to a second chance and forgiveness, because that's what, you know, that's what humans should do. And I would love to see that. I'm a little more skeptical. I think it might take more time, maybe never, but it might, you know, who knows.
But if you were Lance's lawyer and your client was facing a dozen lawsuits, I mean, maybe you tell him to be quiet. I don't know.
Yeah, but he didn't listen to his lawyers when he told them not to go on Oprah.
Yeah.
He didn't listen to them then. So he owes it to me just to look in my eyes, because he doesn't get it. He just doesn't get it. And a lot of people, and a couple journalists here, one journalist in particular, doesn't get it.
Well, I lied. I'm going to do one more. Forgive me.
Pardon me. This is actually, I'm going to direct to Betsy just to clarify. Did you attempt to meet Lance today, as in for this trip?
I wanted to meet him. And he agreed to meet me, and then at the 11th hour, he said no.
Why not?
He said he didn't trust me.
Thank you.
Well, interesting. You waited until the end on that one, huh?
But he's always had somebody else do his dirty work, and he's never faced anybody whom he has hurt so badly. And maybe it's a good thing, because there's shame there. I don't know. I would hope. But I told him we didn't have to talk about anything. Just look me in the eyes. That's all I wanted from him. And I asked him, we have to agree that nobody in the media will ever find out. And he wouldn't agree to that. This whole thing is sad. It's sad. But I hope we can learn from it.
Thank you to our panel.